The crewed moon landings were for sure the crowning achievement of those first years of space exploration. It had a profound impact on our culture and our perception of ourselves. We were now a space-traveling species. Human presence in space began on October 4, 1957, when the first artificial satellite was put in orbit, and since then, there's always been human-made objects in space. People going to space began on April 12, 1961, but so far, we've never gotten anybody, or any living beings for that matter, much further than the moon. Projects like Gemini and Apollo proved that humans could live in space for a couple of weeks at a time at least, but it would be the Soviet Union Salyut program, the world's first space station program, that would push the boundaries of this technology. The Soviets' last great achievement of the space race was the docking of the Soyuz 4 and 5, which became the first ever docking of two crewed spacecraft, and the first transfer of crew from one space vehicle to another, a significant feat for the future space stations. The concept of a kind of vehicle in orbit around the Earth goes back as far as 1869, when American author Edward Everett Hale published his short story The Brick Moon that describes the construction and launch of a 61 meter in diameter sphere made of bricks. Now, in the story, this device gets accidentally launched with people on board, and since they survive, we have the first fictional description of what can be considered a space station. The first serious scientifically grounded considerations of space stations come from Russian scientist Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, the father of Soviet spaceflight, and Romanian scientist Hermann Oberth in the early 20th century. In 1929, Croatian engineer Hermann Potočnik first envisioned the rotating wheel type of space station to create artificial gravity. A fun little related anecdote here was the German World War II concept of the sun gun, which was supposed to be a kind of satellite with a huge mirror attached to it to redirect sunlight to destroy targets on Earth with. More research into this idea was never conducted, but German engineers at the time claimed this weapon could be made somewhere in the coming 50 to 100 years. Now, to be fair, this was right before we invented nukes that could vaporize cities. Flash forward to April 19, 1971, the day the very first proper space station was launched. After the crewed moon landing by the US, the Soviet space program focused on space stations much more than getting their people on the moon. And in the end, the dream of a Soviet crewed moon landing never came true. The Salyut 1 was cylinder-shaped, 20 meters in length, with a maximum diameter of 4 meters and weighing about 18,425 kilograms. It orbited the Earth 3,000 times in 175 days before it was intentionally crashed into the Pacific Ocean. It had solar panels for power and a docking port, and two crewed spacecraft would visit the station, though the Soyuz 10 would fail to dock and had to return to Earth. The Soyuz 11 crew became the first people to live on a space station for 22 days, from June 7 to June 29, 1971, setting a new record for longest stay in space at the time. Sadly, the crew did not make it back to Earth. During their return flight, disaster struck when a ventilation valve was jolted open upon re-entry, depressurizing the interior of their ship. Cosmonauts at the time didn't wear suits while in flight, so all three men suffocated. They are the only people to have ever died above the Kármán line, the unofficial but generally agreed upon edge of space. Salyut 1 was not visited again, while changes and improvements were being made to the Soyuz spacecraft to make it safer. Meanwhile, the US put its own first space station in orbit, Skylab, though the whole mission did not go as planned when the station's micrometeorite shield and one of its solar panels got damaged during launch, leaving the machine with a huge power deficit. Still, Skylab flew for 5 years. Crews clocked a total of 2,000 hours of experiments and scientific research, including monitoring reactions and changes in human physiology during extended stay in microgravity. They did solar physics and astronomy, observations and research of Earth's geology and weather, and land and vegetation patterns, experiments with material science including welding, brazing, metal melting, crystal growth and water and fluid dynamics, and experiments with small animals, including mice, gnats, and spiders. The third crew broke a record by staying on the station for 84 days. Skylab was left uncrewed after 1974 and crashed into the ocean in 1979, when its orbit had decayed so much it fell from it. Now, the USSR remained a space station powerhouse, and five more stations of the Salyut program were launched between 1973 and 1986. The Salyut 2, 3, and 5 were actually stations for military purposes disguised as civilian ones, while the 6 and 7 were proper civilian stations for scientific research. The Salyut 3 would make history by conducting the first test fire of a conventional weapon in space. The Salyut 6 was the first second-generation space station and meant a major breakthrough in capabilities and operational success. Salyut 6 had a second docking port, and while Skylab had this as well, in the Salyut it was actually used, so crew transfers could take place between Soyuz craft. Typically, visiting crews returned to Earth in the older Soyuz which the resident crew had flown to the station, leaving a newer craft for the resident crew as a return vehicle. The Salyut 6 was not occupied continuously. There were six resident crews that were visited by several Soyuz support crews, and uncrewed supply craft that docked into the second port, but in between, the station was empty. America's record for longest stay in space was broken on the Salyut 6, with a crew staying for 96 days, and the longest expedition lasting for 185 days. Most of the visiting expeditions were flown as a part of the Intercosmos program, designed to help Soviet Union allies with crewed and uncrewed missions. Vladimir Remek of Czechoslovakia became the first person in space not from the US or the USSR in 1978, and the station was visited by cosmonauts from Hungary, Poland, Romania, Cuba, Mongolia, Vietnam, and East Germany. And here we can already see the groundwork being laid for future international collaborations we'll see with Mir and the International Space Station. The final station in the Salyut program was the Salyut 7, launched in 1982, visited until 1986, and deorbited in 1991. The Salyut 7 was the 8th space station ever put in orbit and was the link to the next generation of space stations, and acted as a testbed for docking additional modules and expanding operations. It was the last monolithic station, meaning it was a single machine launched into orbit. Its successor, Mir, would be the first modular space station. So a core unit was launched first, and more modules were added later. The legacy of the Salyut program lasts to this day. Two more stations were built after Salyut 7, but were never flown under that name. One was used as the core module for Mir, and the other became the International Space Station's FESDA service module, the third one added to the ISS. Following the success of the Salyut program, Mir represented the next stage in space station history and was an incredible feat of space engineering. It was the first space station to be assembled in orbit. The core module was launched in 1986 and it was completed in 1996. Then it consisted of six pressurized modules where people could live and work, and several unpressurized components. It would remain in orbit until March 2001, when funding was cut off. Mir was the first continuously inhabited long-term research station in orbit and held the record for the longest continuous human presence in space at 3,644 days, until it was surpassed by the ISS on October 23rd in 2010. It was 19 meters long, 31 meters wide, and 27.5 meters high, and weighed 129,700 kilograms. It was occupied for a total of 12.5 years out of the 15 years it was in space, despite having been designed to last only 5 years in orbit, and it had the capacity to support 3 crew members or up to 6 people for shorter visits. International collaborations like the Soviets' Intercosmos, Euromir, and the Shuttle Mir made the station accessible to space travelers from several Asian, European, and North American countries. By the end, the station had been visited by 104 different people from 12 different nations, with the major expeditions lasting around 6 months each. Mir also holds the record for longest single spaceflight by any person. Cosmonaut Valery Polyakov spent 437 days and 18 hours aboard the station, from January 8, 1994 to March 22, 1995. When Mir was crashed, the International Space Station was already being assembled. Its core module launched in 1998, with the first long-term residents arriving on November 2nd in the year 2000. The ISS is the largest space station ever built, with an overall length of 109 meters, 73 meters wide, and weighing 450,000 kilograms. As its name suggests, it's a collaboration between five different space agencies and their contractors: NASA, Roscosmos, ESA, JAXA, and CSA. Its primary purpose is to perform microgravity and space environment experiments in preparation for future endeavors in space. The conceptual history of the ISS is almost as old as space stations themselves. As the space race drew to a close in the early 1970s, the US and the USSR began to contemplate potential collaborations in outer space. This culminated in the Apollo-Soyuz test project in 1975, the first docking of spacecraft from two different spacefaring nations. With this project being successful, both countries continued to consider working together in space. But it would still be a long while and a lot of discarded concepts and projects before the ISS became a thing, also given the political climate of the Cold War. One such concept was a station named the International Skylab, and there were also plans for a Skylab Salyut space station. In the early 80s, NASA wanted to launch a station called Freedom as a counterpart to Salyut and Mir, with Europe's ESA joining in, but all of these plans proved extremely costly. At the same time, the USSR was planning for Mir 2 and had begun constructing modules for it by the mid-80s, but the collapse of the Soviet Union saw these plans in jeopardy as well. Afterwards, American and Russian officials met and proposed their plan should be combined. In September of 1993, both nations announced plans for a new space station, which ended up becoming the ISS. The station has become an international symbol of human capabilities and cooperation, and as of 2024, 281 people from 22 different countries have visited the ISS. In 2011, China's space agency launched their own first space laboratory, Tiangong-1. The station was operational until 2016 and burned up in the atmosphere in 2018. It was visited by three spacecraft, two of which with crew, to test their orbital rendezvous and docking capabilities. Tiangong-2 was launched in 2016 and deorbited as planned in 2019, and served as another test flight for China's own first long-term modular space station, the Tiangong Space Station. The core module of the machine was put in orbit in April of 2021. This was followed by multiple crewed and uncrewed missions, and the addition of two more modules in 2022. The goal for China is to gain experience with this technology, conduct research of their own, and educational and cultural outreach. China's incentive to build their own space stations was amplified after United States Congress prohibited NASA from directly engaging or cooperating with the Chinese Space Agency back in 2011, because of concerns over technology transfer and national security, effectively forbidding any Chinese participation in the ISS. However, China, Russia, and Europe have all agreed to keep a cooperative approach in space, and the Tiangong program has involved help from France, Sweden, and Russia. And as for their current space station, China maintains they're still willing to let foreign astronauts on board to work in space together. Either way, humanity's presence in space is a continuing endeavor, and there's many projects planned for the near future. The ISS will keep operating until 2031. NASA plans to do a controlled deorbit of the station, since the machine is so big an uncontrolled crash could cause damage to property and people. The station was originally designed to work for about 15 years, and so some components are already over 20 years old. In 2026, the Texas-based space company Axiom Space will attach its Axiom orbital segment to the ISS. After the ISS retires, the plan is to build the Axiom into a proper modular station, with the purpose of scientific research but general commercial use as well. Lunar Gateway is a space station planned to be assembled in orbit around the Moon, and intended to serve as a communication hub, science laboratory, and living module for astronauts as a part of the Artemis program, which aims to return people to the Moon. It's currently planned for launch in 2027. Russia plans to pull out of the ISS after 2024. Roscosmos has announced plans for a new Russian station to begin construction in 2027. They also want to put a station in lunar orbit somewhere after 2030. The Indian space agency ISRO plans to launch its own station in 2035. Japan has plans for a space station module to dock with a yet-to-be-determined American private space station, but there's no date for this as of yet. And there are several other private companies that are aiming to have space stations in orbit in the coming decades, which will probably see an increase in space tourism. There have been commercial flights to the ISS, which can cost up to $50 million to spend a week on board, but so far there are no commercial space stations. In the far future, we may see humans build permanent settlements in space where civilians can live, as envisioned in many a sci-fi story. The history of space stations since 1971 has taught us many things about the challenges and long-term effects of living in space. There still is a long way to go before we can even begin building these kinds of places. Still, every step of the way matters, and who knows, one day people will look back to today and wonder what it was like to have just a handful of humans living in space at any given time.